Thank you very much, Ryan. So I'm Chris Huggins, I'm an assistant prof in the School of International Development and Global Studies, and I have the pleasure of organizing the lunchtime speaker series. So we're delighted to have Megan Pickup as our first speaker for this semester. I haven't heard a lot of French being talked around the table yet. This session is going to be mostly in English, but Megan is happy to take questions in French as necessary as well. So Megan is doing her PhD in poli-sci at Calgary University, supervised by Professor Bob McDonald. As you can guess from the title of her talk, her PhD research examines Brazilian South-South cooperation with Haiti, and she's almost finished her thesis. She's getting to that fun time when it's almost time to defend. She's received funding from SHRC as well as from the MITACS program. She's already published in a couple of journals, Contexto Internacional and Canadian Foreign Policy Journal. She published one piece on the foreign policy of the New Left, explaining Brazil's Southern Partnerships, and another piece entitled The Politics of Investment in the Americas, Canada, Brazil, and Post-Neoliberal State. She did her bachelor's in global studies at Trent University and a master's here at the University of Ottawa. So I'll come back, I should say. So yeah, Megan, I'll let you take the lead. Would you like to have you starting off this year?
Okay. Thank you so much, everyone, for coming. And thank you for having me, especially to Ryan and Chris for coordinating everything. So as Chris has said, I'm undertaking a doctoral project that explores the provision of Brazilian humanitarian and development cooperation to Haiti. Brazil is one of so-called emerging donors who have increased their provision of cooperation over the past decade and a half. And this is as part of broader shifts in the global political economy. So as one example, Brazilian cooperation involved only 67 initiatives in 2004, and this peaked to 783 in 2011. So the project is titled Decolonizing Foreign Aid, the Practice of Brazilian South-South Cooperation in Haiti. And there's a lot of terms there that we'll unpack as we go. So my main question was, how does cooperation work as a foreign policy tool? And how does this relate to Brazil's other foreign policy objectives? Why is it that an emerging power would be interested in expanding cooperation? What does it do? And a secondary but related question was, so does Brazil do development any better, or not? Okay. So this desire to be an alternative provider of cooperation is explicit in how Brazilian officials speak about why they give cooperation. In an interview with a high-level official in Brazil's development agency, they're known as Agência Brasileira da Cooperação, he clarified, after he himself used the verb prestar, or to provide. Provide is not the best expression because we do not accept the classification of the providers. We are cooperation partners. When you say that you are providing cooperation, although there is horizontality, there's also a certain inequality. We prefer the expression partner. And this was a lecture that I got on many different occasions for many people. But I chose this quote to immediately give you a sense of the politics embedding the choice to offer South-South cooperation, which I'll refer to as SSC for short, and the form in which they do so. We should question whether this statement and these intentions actually play out, but we can't neglect the reasons why Brazil is trying to define itself in this way. So, in fact, when I argue later on that Brazil has focused on politics at the elite level, I see it very much as a product of Brazil's belief that it and other developing countries too often had their sovereignty impinged upon by great powers, so hence their desire for greater equality in international relations. And I'll return to this context. But first, just a couple of reasons why this project. When I was doing my master's here at U of O, I was studying more internal politics in Brazil. And I started to come across the idea that Brazil was exporting social policies And I thought, well, this is kind of neat. What kinds of policies are these? How do they compare with those pursued domestically? Are they successful? At the same time, the emerging literature on South-South cooperation to me tended to be either a bit too romanticized, yes, this is wonderful, this will be so much better, or overly negative. So they're going to erode important government standards through supporting rogue regimes, et cetera, et cetera. So in the presentation today, I'll define features of SSC broadly and situate the rise of Brazilian cooperation. Then I'll outline the research questions, argument, and methodological choices, discuss some of the main features of Brazilian SSC through the identification of one of its primary strategies. I discussed two in the thesis, but for the sake of time, I'll focus on one that I call building partnership. As part of this, I'll discuss a couple of the strengths and weaknesses of collaboration in Haiti with reference to the global aid effectiveness agenda. And then since I'll hopefully be defending soon, I want to talk about future research plans. SSC is not new. Cooperation has roots in the non-aligned movement, and many of its principles can still be seen, such as the respect for sovereignty and relations based on equality. But, as others have acknowledged, the intensification recently occurs in a fundamentally different context. This includes declining amounts of traditional aid, economic prosperity among emerging powers, including Brazil until of late. And provision also represents a desire to overturn conventional aid practices, which are seen as doing little to change or at worst, actually exacerbating development conditions. So many of the shared principles, if we unpack them, they involve very specific criticisms of traditional aid or official development assistance. And that's what members of the OECD-DAC, or Development Assistance Committee, give or provide. So as one example, the stress on the need to respect internal affairs of developing countries is an explicit reaction against ODA and the implementation of policy conditionalities, perhaps best exemplified by structural adjustment programs. Scholars group non-DAC donors in many different ways, and so who I'm focusing here on really is the BRICS, because they're united at a very broad level by similar discourse around the purpose for their support, even if they differ at the practical level. So some of these shared principles include mutual benefit. This is the idea that the provider should also benefit, whether commercially or by learning from policies or initiatives of its partner. Equality, partnership, etc., where there's an effort to avoid vertical donor relations and ensure the partner state has an active role, including by being the partner who demands the initiative. This is known as demand-driven. That solidarity is a motivation, and that there's a lack of policy conditionalities, but there can be other conditionalities. So the former is really about non-interference in the internal affairs of states, whereas the latter part is about explicitly benefiting. Both parties can benefit. For China, this is really a frank exchange. Then for Brazil specifically, the provision of SSC occurred with an internal shift in government from Fernando Henrique Cardoso's PSDB. This is the Brazilian Social Democratic Party, and social democratic doesn't exactly mean what it means here, to Luiz Inácio Lula da Silva's PT, the Workers' Party. And broadly, the PT is known as post-neoliberal or neo-developmentalist, and this is a term applied to political changes across Latin America. And in general, it refers to governments prioritizing inclusive growth, expanding social welfare programming, and increasing political participation to different extents. This doesn't mean that the PT abandoned neoliberal policies or that they were free from introducing new contradictions. If you've been paying attention to the news at all, I'm sure you've noticed the extent of the massive corruption scandal in Brazil. And arguably, this would have been impossible to the extent that it occurred without this kind of intervention of the state. So while I didn't expect that the government would pursue foreign policy synonymously with domestic policy, I was curious in how this shift would impact the form, what this meant for foreign policy goals, and where cooperation specifically fits within this. So in this context, the following central question drove the project. What does Brazilian development and humanitarian cooperation achieve for Brazil as a post-neoliberal emerging power? Using a within-country case comparison, what are the strategies or constellations of practices defining Brazilian cooperation, and what do they involve, from the actors involved to the ideas that inform them? And how do patients respond to cooperation in terms of its adherence to global aid effectiveness principles and defined priorities of SSC? Why? So these questions stem from my use of practice theory or practice approach. So to step back a bit, I analyze patterns visible in cooperation using a framework developed by the U of O's own Jackie Best as sort of a springboard. So in her 2014 book on provisional governance from international financial institutions, she tries to study strategies and the actual practice of financial institutions. So in a way, I backwards engineer what cooperation achieves by starting from foreign policy statements, from literature on what the Brazilian government was attempting to do, and then bringing this very much to the micro level in Haiti. The approach is historical, concerned with Brazil's history as an aid recipient, how its domestic changes under the PT influence cooperation, but also how the Haitian government may have reacted in particular ways because of their own record as a recipient. I can come back to case selection with questions, but mainly I chose Haiti because it's the site of other prominent Brazilian foreign policy actions, especially leadership of the UN mission MINUSTA, and that I think Haiti amplifies many of the weaknesses of traditional aid because it's seen as a fragile state. Often donors have worked outside of the public system, which problematically actually further erodes public institutions. In the thesis, I argue that cooperation has been positively received by Haitian authorities, resulting in clear but short-term political gains, mainly because of Brazil's commitment to capacity building through direct engagement with Haitian officials. However, in approaching aid as a practice, I conclude that the features of cooperation and the Haitian state's response are inexplicable without a post-colonial interpretation, recognizing Brazil's desire to position itself as an alternative to the West, and Haiti's consistent and problematic treatment as fragile in its aid relations. So this is where the concept of decolonizing aid comes from. It's about capturing how emergent forms of successive cooperation occur in a context of decolonial politics. But this is a contradictory and incomplete process. It is not overly positive by any means. The method was really interpretative and historical. So I wanted to embed cooperation in social structures, especially colonial and post-colonial ones. I historicized Brazilian cooperation and situate Haitian responses within their history of fraught relations with external governments. All the information I collected was subject to process tracing. And the focus was on where and how cooperation changed political relations over time. I examined government documents, speeches, and secondary literature, and carried out 57 interviews in Brazil and Haiti. They were mainly elite interviews, so Brazilian government officials, other bilateral donors, and international organizations. But I also conducted some interviews with direct project recipients. These were farmer associations, school and hospital administrators, and I also visited the project sites where it was feasible. So, obviously I want to spend most of the time talking about what Brazil actually does in Haiti, but I should give you a bit of context about the case studies. So because it was to Haiti, Brazil did offer humanitarian and development cooperation. And this is important because humanitarian is sometimes a bit more short-term and involves more of a financial contribution than is typical for Brazil. Usually Brazil simply contracts out people who work in its domestic departments and ministries. So they're basically in-kind contributions. And so I examined four case studies, two in the health sectors and two in the agricultural sectors. The first was the Institute for the Rehabilitation of Persons with Disabilities. And right beside a community hospital that was also built, the idea was that this would give diverse supports to the Haitian population, who after the earthquake suffered from a huge increase in physical disabilities. The second project was support for the milk sector and improvement of household food security. So one part of this was supporting increased milk production. The part that I looked at was linking this to school feeding programs. Then for the agricultural projects, one was about strengthening seed production and distribution capacities, intending to improve productivity of small-scale farmers. The last was a pilot project, and this one had been delayed multiple times, but I kept with it because I thought it could serve almost as a counterfactual. What's been going wrong? Why have there been so many delays? And again, the idea is that this could improve productivity for farmers. These are a couple of pictures of the community hospital that the Institute for Rehabilitation was beside.
Where is that?
This is just outside Port-au-Prince. And this institute was a direct request by then President Preval to President Lula. This next slide shows one of the farmer associations that I spoke with. And this was in the context of the project to increase production by focusing on seed quality.
Where?
So this was in the Artibonite region of Haiti.
Do you know where? In
Haiti? It was I'll look it up and then I'll tell you after. Okay. So in the thesis, I argue Brazil sought to deliver cooperation that was characterized by two strategies. The first was building partnerships with the Haitian state, and the second was designing more appropriate strategies, more appropriate projects and interventions. And as I said, I want to only focus on the first for time, but I should give you a sense of the second because they're really related. The first is really about processes of cooperation. How do we interact with the state? The second is about the content of projects. So Brazil's criticism would be that most development projects look alarmingly alike, irrespective of place, history, politics, economy, social relations. So when problems are treated universally and blueprint solutions are implemented, development hasn't really gotten anywhere. Instead, Brazil thinks that as a government that was successful domestically in reducing poverty and inequality, we have some important lessons to share. In terms of building partnership, the problem or what's motivating Brazil to intervene in the form that it does is what they see as a lack of sustained commitment to ownership by traditional donors. Ownership is one principle for global aid effectiveness, agreed to by donors in the OECD DAC. And basically the idea is that governments should lead their own development plans. This is very much related to the principles of horizontality, provision and not aid. And so Brazil has emphasized creating partnerships. However, beyond Brazil's wish to distance itself from governments, from donors being the one to lead efforts, the strategy was also very much shaped by specific foreign policy goals of Brazil. So Brazil saw its self-interest as compatible with the rise of the South more generally. As Celso Amorim, a former Minister of Foreign Relations, said, the national interest and solidarity are not necessarily antagonistic. In many ways, generosity is a reflection of a clear vision, putting long-term interests of the whole nation over immediate gains in this or that sector. So I see strong resonances with the post-neoliberal emphasis on a more interventionist state as the driver of development. This is really different from the OECD conceptualization of ownership in a way, because good governance is something required a priori. The Brazilian notion is instead about interaction with our partner, however gradual, however incremental, however many times we go backwards and not forwards, can eventually lead to capacity improvements. And so defining the problem in this way leads to certain techniques or ways of making things happen. Projects were a result of explicit political demands, and in the day-to-day workings, partners would go through, for example, multiple versions of concept notes. And these set out ideas about what projects will be undertaken, making sure projects meet the priorities of Haitian officials. This was why the fourth project that I looked at, the pilot project, had been delayed for so long, because they go back and forth. And so for Haitians, obviously, in the government, they were pretty pleased to be taken seriously as participants. A Haitian doctor involved in the Institute for Disabilities argued that the model was very flexible. Quote, we always try to bring the most appropriate results together. Unlike traditional donors, he continued, Brazil is characterized by permanent listening and is a constant participant in order to react to problems. And what was really interesting for me was even when the interview questions didn't frame against traditional aid in any explicit way, for my respondents, it was always the implicit comparison. And so how I read this was that their way of working establishes Brazilian authority to be there as development providers, but as a very specific kind of provider. It's a specific kind of authority, almost a moral authority. And what I mean by this is that there was a sense in which people believed Brazil was truly acting out of solidarity. And this doesn't mean that they weren't ignorant to the fact that MINUSTA existed, that there were other major foreign policy goals, but there wasn't a sense in which cooperation was being instrumentalized for these reasons. They thought that the benefits were kind of indirect. So now, some of the results or the effects. Why is it that these projects are an important way through which Brazil constructs a particular regional and global image as an emerging power with a moral authority deriving its power from its interactions with developing country states? What does cooperation do for its partners? So for Haiti, potentially these actions lead to improvements to capacity, especially if they occur alongside the content of projects and initiatives and expand state functions. So again, because projects had this post-neoliberal undertone, the state was seen as playing an important role. So in two of the projects, the state would eventually guarantee purchase from farmers, linking this to school feeding programs. Brazil's processes of responding to demands, negotiating with partners at technical and higher decision-making levels, these are all underwritten by what I think are fairly radical notions of the Haitian state possessing capacity and the political will to develop. According to one Haitian official, the Brazilian approach doesn't impose anything. It brings a project that the government wanted and also what addresses the misery of the population. This approach isn't free from conflict or challenges. Throughout, time and money was wasted as negotiations dragged on. The Brazilian response to this would be partnerships take time to develop. These are normal processes of building partnerships. I think the more serious concern is what the centralization of state power can lead to. For those in the bureaucracy not developmentally minded, and for those interested in personal gain. A couple of stories of this were shared with me, very frankly. And so I think, as per more a DAP logic than a Brazilian logic, is there assurance that there's buy-in from society more broadly? This isn't just something at the elite level. And so to emphasize it again, for Brazil, this is elite state-state relations. That's what matters. And it shouldn't be surprising, given their background assumption, that states would pursue development if not for the interference of other more powerful states. So some more critical civil society voices that I spoke with expressed their concern that Brazil is complicit with the Michel Martelly government. But in the short term, at least, I think that Brazil has had some clear political gains as a result of its efforts. Because it truly partners with the state and tries to put forth more appropriate models, it was very much perceived favorably by its Haitian counterparts and even by other donors working in Haiti. One researcher of a global development organization told me he conducted a survey with Haitian ministries. He asked, who is a model donor in Haiti? They all said Brazil. So cooperation helps to project Brazilian global leadership. A former advisor to the Haitian government explained it in this way. It's not the North or the West, it's our brothers and sisters. So there are really important symbolic aspects to this. And to reiterate the significance, aid has to be understood relationally. The failure of traditional aid to ensure ownership has been egregious in the Haitian context, with a tendency to bypass the state. So Brazil's preference for working with ministries is even more unique in this context. So I'll summarize briefly before going to some of the research plans. Brazil wants to put forward new models for development cooperation. And it has offered cooperation in a way that appeals to governments by focusing on state-state relations, and to some extent in offering cooperation that better prioritizes developing country needs. The processes and substance of cooperation, anchored as they are in perceptions of the state as an active and legitimate authority, resulted in political recognition from partners in the broader international community, which supports Brazil as a specifically post-neoliberal emerging power working to decolonize aid in a contradictory way. But the approach has different challenges. And most of the concerns I raise about what Brazil does for development are more related to the second strategy. But to give you a brief sense of these, my concern is whether they can build sustainable solutions over the long term. Paradoxically, in trying to counter universal prescriptions with its post-neoliberal models, it has instead kind of rigidly promoted these other ways of doing development, but not recognizing differences in context. it assumes the Haitian state has the same capacity that the Brazilian state did domestically, which is a huge problem, including for the simple reason that it is a resource-poor context. So one of the most interesting and significant findings, I think, was recognition that Brazil builds global power not simply through how its partners perceive cooperation, but how it is perceived by other powers. And in a very direct way, emerging and traditional powers have increasingly worked together in triangular arrangements. So these are believed to capture the comparative advantages of both donors, where Brazil supposedly shares socioeconomic, cultural traits with the partner or recipient, and has expertise based on development programs and overcoming some of its own poverty and inequality. So my future goal would be, do other emerging donors gain positive reputational changes from their participation in triangular cooperation? At the same time, I'm interested in why partner countries might want to use these arrangements rather than bilateral initiatives. On the surface, they actually seem to be worse in terms of adhering to aid effectiveness principles. So the main questions would be, what do southern countries expect to gain from these arrangements? How does triangular cooperation expand or undermine the ability of southern countries to participate in governing global development, including their ability to determine the priorities and direction of triangular initiatives? And the plan would be to carry out a cross-national survey and then do field work on some specific case studies. So thank you again for coming. I look forward to your questions and comments.
Thanks, Megan, for a very, very clear and well-ordered and very articulate presentation of fairly complex set of issues there. That was really great. We'll take comments and questions from the floor.
Well, you mentioned it started under President Préval.
Mm-hmm.
That's minimally 7 or 8 years. Have any of these projects achieved success, like the food security or the rehabilitation center? Those kinds of things, would you say that they're functioning and they're successful today?
I think many of them have had some very minimal improvements. One positive about the milk project, for instance, is that this was an initiative started by a local organization in Haiti. And so Brazil took on funding and was able to sort of continue and expand this. But as I was sort of hinting at near the end, for the case studies that I looked at in depth, I was concerned about the kinds of impacts they would have over the long term once Brazil stopped financing them. Because most the ideas rooted in them are demand such an interventionist state, and I think it's just fundamentally at odds with what Haitian ministries will be able to step in and do.
Otherwise, in less diplomatic language, Haitian Haiti is incapable of financing just about anything, right?
Yes, with the extent to which their income is based on external aid.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Ryan has reminded me, we have a fairly intimate group here, so if you wouldn't mind just kind of introducing yourself before you make a comment, and we can get to know each other a little bit more as you go ahead.
Do you want to go retroactively? My name is Steve Harris. I do volunteer work in Haiti, where we finance schools and a health center and agricultural projects. And yes, we bypass the government. Most of our work is done under their authorization, but without any financing or managerial stuff, because I guess they don't have that capacity, nor the interest.
Okay, thank you.
My name is William Sheridan. I guess we can call it just an interested observer. In terms of looking at countries like Haiti, in other words, what was traditionally called the recipients of Haiti, given all the problems that you've discussed with Haiti, and it wouldn't be a big surprise if a lot of other countries on the receiving end of Haiti also display many of those same kinds of problems. Has anyone, how shall I say it, done an assessment of those countries so that you can say they have 34 characteristics of these kinds, and because of that, it makes it very difficult for them to sustain efforts even when they're given help to begin with. So we've got to do this, and this in our building of institutions so that they can become sustainable. Is there, and if so, can you share with us what they would be? Because that seems to be an enormous problem for development anywhere. In other words, if it really is the most effective way to do it, to have a capable state, and if they're nowhere near having a capable state, what really has to be done so that you can ensure that they can't build a capable state? If you can't say that, then you're putting in a lot of time and effort and you go to hope, but in the long run it won't amount to anything anyway, just as the fears are there. So has anybody said, okay, that's fair enough then. Let's find out what we need to do, and then let's do it.
Okay.
What do you think?
Now that raises a lot of debates within the field of development. And I by no means feel that I will definitively answer them, but I can give you my own thinking on it. So as I've tried to hint at a bit throughout, I think that traditional donors as encapsulated by the OECD versus southern countries like Brazil approach this in very different ways. The one is that for the most part there should be certain conditions of good governance that already exist. The other is that we can actually build some of these conditions through engagement itself and through that process. I personally am sympathetic to the latter and to Brazil's. And so within the broader project, I have to struggle a bit with sort of celebrating that characteristic, while at the same time criticizing in a fair way, I think, their inability to plan effectively enough so that they could see some of the conditions. Because what I think is that you could work with the state if projects were designed in a way that some of these characteristics have been taken into account. So was there a point in building an institute where the government couldn't pay salaries after Brazil steps away? I'm not sure, but we should ask. My problem is not that they worked with the state, it's what they assumed the state could do. So it's tricky, it's very tricky. I don't have an answer to.
Thank you very much for the presentation. My name is Mark Farron. I'm a consultant demographer specialized in international health. And I've been associated with things in Brazilian for about, about 40 years perhaps. And curiously, in the 2005 period, when just before Preval was coming on to power, and Brazil was involved in MINUSCA, UN stabilization force. And so I was part of this triangular or trilateral cooperation in Brazil, Haiti, Canada.
Okay.
The idea was, well, Brazil is kind of a new role. We're crossing the street and becoming a donor, and Canada Canada is a long time ally, non-colonial either, mm-hmm. you know, and with the, you know, extra, not part of the France, England, all this, and the USA kind of thing. So I was involved in a lot of this back and forth in the meetings and how do you sort of, get Brazil coming through this situation, enhancing its, I think its role and its participation in the world. In fact, even though there's lots to talk about the internal dynamics of individual projects, my feeling is that Itamaraty, the Brazilian Foreign Affairs, people are seeing this as a global kind of mm-hmm. matter. Number one, mm-hmm. just having given the leadership of the MINUSCA was a struggle, and there were other parts of the world, non-Latin parts of the world, where they were trying to edge their way in with a lot of regional solidarity with the Argentinians, you know, being, you know, partners with the Brazilians in the other parts of Latin America. We're going to keep those Jordanians or whoever it is out, and like, we got the ball here, you know, we're going to hold on to it, and we're going to show them that, you know, we are a serious player in the international community. And I think a lot of, there was such internal angst with that engagement of having the Brazilian military out there on the front lines. Mm-hmm. And I think a lot of their, in Itamaraty's thing was, well, how can we, you know, we don't want to be seen by the Haitians or anybody as the guys with the guns. In fact, you know, 40 years ago, you know, there were a lot of guns in Brazil and it wasn't a very nice situation. It was a dictatorship. So it's really, how do you transform yourself and transit into a new role in the world? So this idea, we don't want to be seen as the guys with the guns, so we'd like to be seen as the guys here, you know, willing to help not just only stabilize, but, you know, the next levels of relief, recovery, rehabilitation, development, et cetera, et cetera. So the idea, we'll team up with Canada, so we get on the boat, you know, across the other side of the street. I think really the long-term goal is we in Brazil want a seat in the Security Council. We should be a permanent member of the Security Council. Mm-hmm. And your reference to BRICS, you got two people in the Security Council there already. You know, so you're sort of like, we're in that club. And so, you know, they push you want to be. And that's really what their goals are, the long-term goals are there. And I think it's also important within that very context of highlighting more the idea of a Brazilian soccer diplomacy. I mean, Brazil linked up the soccer team to Haiti, and boy, oh boy, the whole country was mobilized around Brazil, and, you know, even months later, you could find any sort of Brazilian man, in particular, he might not have any money on him, but he would have inside, in his wallet, you know, Brazilian soccer player. You know, who looked a lot like him in many cases. So, you know, that was the real, I think, you know, magic of this outreach, you know, to, and like, to me, you know, we're all very disappointed with, you know, where Brazil is today, and given that where it was 40 years ago and the promise that we all had 20 years ago mm-hmm. Of where the country should be going. You know, it's a really, you know, question of, you know, how sincere and how coherent, you know, was the being a development assistant partner really part of a big package. To me, it was almost, at the end of the day, it was almost accessory. You know, it was kind of more gratuitous, very good, well, I won't say posturing, but, you know, positioning, and, you know, I think that's where the real action is in Itamaraty. And they are, Itamaraty, I happened to be like 30 years ago when we had a CETA working, and Canada did have a program of cooperation with Brazil, right. Only because Pierre Trudeau on a visit there like in 78, he's like, well, Brazil is not a poor country, really shouldn't be a partner, but oh well, you know, we had a partnership for an extra 10 years. So the Brazilian, they have never been very keen on NGOs. They see them as troublesome, even though most of the people in leadership now, they came from NGOs 30 years ago during the dictatorship. But they don't want to deal with NGOs because it's messy, and you lose control. So that's why the whole part of the state, they want to control it. That's how I see it.
Mm-hmm. Okay, so quite a few.
Well, anyway, sorry, but I think there's those dimensions that, like you get some, you know.
There were some questions maybe implicit in that, and certainly all too much.
There's a lot that I could get into, and I'm sure as people interested so much in Brazil, we would have a lot to talk about one-on-one too. But I will just touch on a couple. So the first is, in terms of some of the global effects, well, everything that I read about in terms of Brazil and other countries sounds remarkably like what I found in Haiti. So both in terms of quite often very favorable reactions from government partners, but also similar types of criticisms emerge. So, and I'm thinking about one article in particular on Mozambique, where they criticize the assumptions about the political economy of Brazil and how it would match the Mozambican. And they say, well, you know, on capital, land, and labor, there are all of these differences in what they are. You know, in terms of how development cooperation fits into larger foreign policy goals, whether it's genuine, whether it matters, I very much think it does. I don't think that a means or a vehicle can be underestimated simply because it has an ideational component. And in fact, some of the smaller contributions in the thesis are, you know, how does Brazil compare with China? Does it matter that these are small financially? And I think that's actually what helps Brazil. These are symbolic efforts. And of course, as any IR theorist, at some point I recognize that ideas have to match material reality. But because they've done so well in these government processes, that has kind of sustained the ideas and identity aspects of it. But yeah, again, I'm sure we have people to talk about it.
I'm Stephen Brown, I'm a professor of political science, to close up. Megha, thank you for a very interesting talk. I'm really interested, as you know, in the concept of ownership. And you sort of threw it in, didn't go into any much detail. And hopefully you can unpack it a bit. Because you started off with the one sort of sentence summary of what ownership means is the government leads development. But and that's fine for the one sentence version. Mm-hmm. But the one paragraph version has to sort of recognize that, well, who's the government? Is it the executive? Is it the legislative? Mm-hmm. And the international principles of aid effectiveness have evolved on this issue, from ownership to national ownership to democratic ownership, and brought an idea that it's not just executives or not just whatever the president says goes, and maybe not even parliament, but there has to be some sort of input from society. Or so I was wondering how this plays out in Haiti in terms of, like, where is ownership embodied, and how legitimate is that ownership? Because if you have a state that's not, like, a government that's not very legitimate, and or a state that's not very legitimate, maybe there's nuance between them, like, to what extent do they embody, or can they embody ownership?
Mm-hmm. I'm really glad that you brought that up, because if I had had more time, something that I didn't want to get into was not only the difference between more DAC and Brazilian logic, but how the DAC logic has evolved over time. So now I think it's fair to say that it's not just about ownership, it's about an inclusive sense of ownership. So the state has to be legitimate, it has to be a reflection of broader society. And again, I won't repeat what I said in response to one of the questions before, which is simply that I think there is something to the idea that through interaction, some of those broader state-society linkages can be consolidated. But the question is, how legitimate is, like, what degree of legitimacy is enough? And when is a governance record so poor that a state shouldn't be partnering, perhaps, with them, but should engage grassroots and civil society levels?
It's not just who you engage with, it's what you engage in.
Right.
So the choice to prioritize not only health and agriculture, but those four projects that you talked about, like, how much does that reflect broad ownership or a very narrow, something, I don't know.
So that's the next part of where I was going to go, because...
Okay,
No, it's okay, but surprisingly, perhaps, all of the projects did involve a lot of very local grassroots organizations, like the farmer associations. And as I said, I think I need to stress that there were some methodological limits in terms of what I did there, because for me, the focus was very much on political relations at the state level. But for those whom I did speak with, it was just as positive from farmer associations, school administrators, and hospital administrators. It wasn't just officials in the government. And they felt like they had been consulted, like the project met their needs. And the only criticism was that money wasn't going to continue, that the project wasn't going to continue. The only more critical comment from civil society that I mentioned was a more political organization, so they weren't a recipient of any of the cooperation efforts. But it's difficult because I'm no Haitian expert by any means, but the level of civil society and the kinds of groups that exist are more limited too. So, I can't say for sure that I got the most accurate representation of how other groups beyond the Haitian government perceive cooperation. But I think that the strongest civil society criticisms are coming from the Brazilian civil society.
Can I just jump in with a follow-up?
Of course.
Here's my position as chair. Looking at the list of projects that you had, some of these, the milk production to, I think, schools, and then the kind of small farming to school lunches and things like that.
Mm-hmm.
These are very much part and parcel of Brazilian food security policies and agricultural growth policies, which have become kind of a classic case and have been much discussed and everything else. So when you were talking to the local stakeholders and local people involved in those projects, did they talk about those approaches as the Brazilian way or the Brazilian, in terms of that ownership of the ideas, the kind of policies that would be put together? Were these something which were seen as coming organically from discussions on the ground, or was it very much the Brazilian model of development? Yeah.
That's such a good question, because interestingly enough, there wasn't really much recognition at the local level that it was from Brazil at all. Where there was acknowledgement that it was the Brazilian way was international organizations, so the Food and Agricultural Organization, especially, and the World Food Program. So they would say things like, we're not doing it the old way anymore. Now we have Brazil's innovation, so we can improve on this long-standing role that we've had in Haiti. At the local level, other than people being generally supportive, there wasn't a lot of talk about who it was coming from, which for me actually reconfirmed a lot of what I was thinking about. Why they do it is for the political relations at a higher level. Development is sort of nice, but kind of secondary.
little bit different from Canada?
No.
In that sense, no.
Please go ahead.
Thank you. I'm Karen Moore. I'm a master's student in development, and Professor Higgins is my thesis supervisor.
Okay.
I just wanted to follow up on when you were commenting that the hospital administrators, the people from the farmers' associations, the schools were commenting positively. Did you get any sense of whether there's any dynamic of coercion or pressure from government officials to speak positively about the project, or you know what that dynamic might be like in Haiti?
That's a great question. Undoubtedly, there is.
Because I have no idea. I don't know that context, but it just crossed my mind that that could be possible.
So, I think that in a context like Haiti, where there is such a dependency on external money, that is not an easy problem to avoid. Something that I did methodologically was I had gone to Brazil first, and Brazilians are quite happy to talk, and they're very frank about problems too and conflicts. And when I got to Haiti, people were quite hesitant to talk to me, and there was no way that it was going to happen unless it was anonymous. So I changed that, and everything ended up being anonymous. And so I think, I'd like to think that to some extent that that helped ameliorate that potential challenge, but it's certainly not totally preventable. I also think that what helped was that I most often spoke to sort of mid-level officials. So they were involved in negotiations, they were experts on technical input, but it wasn't like just a political line either. And so I did hear some real criticisms. So for instance, I spoke to someone in the Haitian ministry about the seed project. So a small group of farmers were testing these different varieties that were going to be more disease resistant and so on. And then a larger group of farmers was getting vouchers to purchase these higher quality seeds. And so the official in the Ministry of Agriculture said, well, you know, this is all well and good, but how will it keep going in the long term when the way that they're selling the seeds isn't the traditional Haitian way, which is a marmite, it's just a certain measurement. So it's like in these very finer details, things go astray a bit. But I think the fact that that kind of information was shared with me hopefully attests to the fact that it wasn't just, you know, this official line.
I have a question, just out of curiosity. Have you come across through your research anything indicating a shift or change or response from the Development Assistance Committee itself in terms of how not just Brazilian and South South cooperation, but right now China's interest in strategic and calculated.
Right.
Is there have you seen anything about how DAC is responding, or do they see this the BRICS to South foreign aid being a threat? Are they interested in changing how they're thinking about development?
And an interesting question is not only, you know, are they perceived as a threat, but are they socializing global norms? Well, I would say, at least at the individual level, because I did talk to a number of bilateral donors and international organizations, they're they're worried about being left behind, and they know how to talk about it, so they know how to champion all of these principles in a simplistic way. And you know, they share these traits with the partner countries, so that's why we need to work with them. They're more successful, so we can, like in the case of the World Food Program, we can overcome our old-fashioned way of doing it. So the kind of public line is that there, it's an opportunity. But I would say that there is concern and some degree of threat there too, because a lot of these informants were just as hesitant to talk to me as patients. And with one even, I haven't included even as an anonymous source, because he was so hesitant that it just seemed better to just have it sort of as an informational interview. But more privately, these people would express some of their questions, like, well, was our aid ever not demand-driven? I mean, if we're the former colonial powers, can we ever overcome that? What are we supposed to do? So they might not be threatened in the same way that they are with China and the sheer weight of it all, but I think they're threatened by the fact that there's another option and they're being criticized. But I really want to look into that more.
Margaret Lang, I'm taking a course at Carleton University in Global Development, just an introductory course, and I'm really enjoying it. My background is also in evaluation, and I'm sitting here and thinking, like, is there a body of evaluation literature that looks at, over the years, what's worked and what doesn't work, and in what context? And because the question that's arising in my mind as I look at developmental aid is, what are the long-term impacts? And what I'm starting to see is there are short-term impacts, but nobody's talking about long-term, like, is it sustained? And it's not just because there may not be a state that can manage it, but I heard the other day in a presentation on aid to Afghanistan that, in fact, it's a very local level cultural thing. If people have different attitudes and they're introducing new practices, can they be sustained without the aid? And once the aid ends, they go back to their former practices and attitudes and behaviors. So is there any kind of a body of literature and evaluation that's developing, sort of what works and what? I don't know if that's a fair question or not.
No, I mean, there absolutely is. But for Brazil, part of their difference and their efforts to be different are kind of resisting many of those standards, including evaluation. Although there are tensions, so they have a manual on managing cooperation, and it's actually, if you read it and you read something from Canada's Global Affairs, a lot of the language is the same, so they both have results-based management, for instance. But do they actually do that? Not really. And they're criticized for it. So I think it's improving, but I think it's a real problem. And one of my thesis chapters tries to apply global aid effectiveness principles to the case studies and to also develop principles that I think are more appropriate to CESF cooperation. And I find a very mixed record for the projects I examined, but I think that Brazil has a lot of work to do in looking at long-term effects and outcomes. But I don't think they've been concerned.
Thank you. I have some questions. I'll make it myself until we've.
Okay, if I could help answer that, organizations that work on the ground know that expecting the Haitian state to finance anything is out of the question. So when we build schools, we finance schools, we have built it on the principle that the people themselves would finance a school through school fees. And that's a bit optimistic, because when there's a drought, they have no money. You know, it's an agricultural-based economy once you get outside the city. And the schools that are able to pay their teachers, and we're talking $100 a month, which is a typical salary for a teacher in Haiti primary school, are the functioning of the school is often financed by a parish in North America or in Europe or something. Often it's parish schools that are connected with and you know, parishes elsewhere, and they're financing that school 100%. Even the infrastructure, like bridges and roads that have been built by other countries, the state doesn't maintain them. You know, that internal functionality of the state is basically not there. They've got police, you know, and Lord knows, the budget for the legislators, the deputies and the senators and their expenses exceeds the budget for the national budget for health in Haiti. So figure that one out. And therefore, the hospitals are functioning on a third to half capacity, often with many people in there, like the nurses, not being paid. I imagine like 2-3 years without salary. And I asked them, why are they still working? Well, they get 2 meals a day in the hospital. So that's their compensation. What are they going to do if they don't go to work and get fed? So it's pretty rough.
I think, Randall, you want to?
I'll chime in. I have no background in development, really. I'm just your everyday political scientist, but upriver. So I would be interested, this isn't really part of your presentation, but probably you come back to this in your dissertation, Megan. I'd be interested in any insights you've gleaned from your on-the-ground research that you've done about your starting point, your theoretical starting point, the practice approach. I mean, did anything that you've learned suggest that we ought to adapt, modify, move beyond, retract, or is the practice approach perfect? Okay, so that's kind of, that's one. Another question I have, I mean, you know, we're, the extent that we follow foreign policy, you know, we're always told that it's really a reflection of the internal values of the country. So, you know, Canada's foreign policy in Haiti, you want to find out why, the first thing you look at is what's going on in Canada, right? Is there, and you've just talked about non-governmental reaction in Haiti, is there a kind of a, you know, is this South-South cooperation that you've described coming out of Brazil driven at all outside of the state in Brazil amongst NGOs, civil society, Canadian development policy has evolved over the years in relation to what Canadians have said about it. Have you looked at that at all in Brazil?
So the first question, that's such an interesting one, because the first committee member who responded to my thesis said, you know, Megan, you've actually gone a lot beyond the framework you say that you're using and made your own contribution. And so that's why I try to introduce the decolonizing concept. Again, not to suggest that, you know, this has been a perfect process and that it hasn't introduced new tensions, but that when you look at how practices occur in a decolonial, post-colonial context, you see some very different things. You see different background knowledge or the history of ideas and why certain practices are influential. But what I'd like to do in the future is also to consider the role of emotion and this is something in IR that I honestly haven't read much about, but the way that cooperation is spoken about by all of those involved, by Brazil, by Haitians, by IOs even, and the symbolic brothers and sisters, I mean, people could criticize Brazil and in the same breath conclude that it was an overly positive process and outcome. And I think that, you know, emotion and wanting the post-colonial, the non-colonial power to be better actually affects how people judge and evaluate. So these are some things that I want to look into. But I would say that versus where I started, I don't think practice is, and maybe it didn't mean to be, so this might not be a fair criticism, but I do not think it's a theory. It's an approach. It's almost like an ontological starting point. What are you looking at? And it doesn't actually implicate a particular theory at all. Like, and I think it's Puglia that has a book that's several different IR traditions use practice. So I think Lee Hansen has a post-structural practice approach in it, for instance. And so I would agree with that. I think it's actually quite open. So the challenge for them would be, is it actually contributing something theoretically? Or is it just a starting point? And if so, what are the limits of that? Are we asking it to do more than it can do? And then the Brazilian question, and I guess foreign policy making in Brazil. So, well, this is a thing I could go on about, so I'll try not to. But even though processes of democratization have opened up foreign policy decision making, it's still very closed off relative to other countries. And so the MINUSTA example that you brought up before, it was actually a rare moment in that people generally were paying attention and even that it was being debated in Congress. Generally, it's sort of the purview of elites. And those in Itamaraty have been kind of free to exercise their diplomatic judgment about those different situations. And so that's changed for different reasons, including presidents wanting to take on a more active role. But like the civil society groups in Brazil involved in this are very limited.
Well, I have the impression that when Brazil joined in the leadership of the MINUSTA operation, there, I think there was quite a bit of concern internally about not only the ECMRT, but in terms of political class, that the Brazilian civil society, the NGOs, which there are many, that they were actually against it, quite far against it. And you can say, well, this is like here, our military, they took over our country in 1964, and here our bad guys are out there now masquerading as Democrats. So that, I think, forced Itamaraty then to up the volume and the rhetoric and dress it up in, you know, more elaborate clothes. It's Brazil's role in the world and solidarity and all the language, you know. So they were really forced to, you know, give a high profile in order to, you know, counteract the people at their own base who really weren't on board with the operation. So, and I think they've been reasonably successful in avoiding an internal conflict. So I think that, they did their homework, but I think it should be seen in that context that it was really quite a daring move, you know, for Brazilian to get out there into the international community and get the rifles in the hand. Mm-hmm. And I think that, you know, I'd say bravo at the end, you know, given all the bumps that could be on the road. They lost people, they lost a leader, a general. I'd say that they mission accomplished in the sense that, you know, occupying a bigger footprint in the world and trying to be a more coherent and consistent and believable player in the larger scheme of things. Everyone's playing that.
Yeah, we have time for maybe two more comments or questions, and then we'll finish up. Okay, again, go ahead, Steve.
So everything that I've seen so far so lately is about the shot tool and all of that stuff. You probably follow it more closely than I do.
Mm-hmm.
Have you seen any change in Brazilian development cooperation policy since Temer became president?
Less than I would have anticipated. But there have been some. So the agency in charge of humanitarian cooperation was actually CG Fome, not ABC. And they were folded. And I found that interesting because it was one of the most, there were some of the most critical interviews with Brazilian officials. So as one contrast, they support Brazilian civil society involvement and development and humanitarian cooperation, whereas ABC is very, very hesitant. But the projects have kept going so far, which has surprised me. It's
past
just
the tendency, or?
I guess so. But for how long? Because when the model is based on our own domestic bureaucrats having expertise and sharing that through technical cooperation, many of these domestic ministries will also be ones that I could anticipate having less authority and money. You know, of Brazil's two agricultural ministries, one more dedicated to agribusiness and one more small-scale farming. Well, I don't think the Temer government is that interested in the small-scale farmers. So there's a way in which I think their model is subject to political changes that's even more amplified than you would see under, say, a Canadian change of government, but less than I would have expected so far. So we'll see.
Yes.
Yes, which leads me to a proposal, an interpretation of what the Brazilian government is, quote, doing. Sounds to me as if what the Brazilian government is doing in doing this kind of partnership aid is really trying to, I won't say impose because they can't, but shall I say share, what they really want to share is their system of governance with other countries in their neighborhood, so that, which will give them something in common, so that in terms of international affairs, for instance, they can talk to one another because they know what they're doing and they know how they do it, and that's the basis of cooperation in those kind of situations.
Do you mean left wing?
Not necessarily left wing, but what the view from the top. Whether it's right wing, left wing, or in the middle, it doesn't matter the point of what it is. The government takes the lead role. And it does so in Brazil. And what it's saying to other countries is, come on, guys, this is how it's done. Let's get on board.
Mm-hmm.
And Haiti is an example.
Yeah, I think that's very true. I think it's we'd like to remake the world in a way that where Brazilian ideas are dominant. And I think that they would... The Brazilian consensus. And they would
so
see...
So it is neo-colonialism. That's wonderful. I like you on a viper job.
And posts like of the WTO and the FAO are signals that they've succeeded to them.
And so there would be more of them.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Well, not anymore, but this is a...
But my suggestion is that I think it's only since the advent of left-wing governments in the South that we've seen foreign aid from on the part of those countries. And those left-wing governments are attempting to cut into the American influence at the OAS and every other level. So you've got Cuba, Venezuela, Brazil, but Brazil only since it got a left-wing government.
also about Mexico, though, and Chile.
Mm-hmm. Mexico and Chile?
Yeah, Mexico has its own development agents.
Okay.
That makes it. And they're growing.
So there's mm-hmm. your second thesis. Instead of the whole region and how the policies
This is terrific.
Maybe bring the postdoc funding.
Exactly.
And
so
you've got
Okay, well, thanks everyone, and thanks again to Megan. On my part, I'll just finish again by reminding you that we have another lunchtime speaker, as Ryan already mentioned, coming up fairly soon. And as Ryan also mentioned, if you haven't already looked at the SIPS website and signed yourself up for the mailing list, please do that.
And there's an event tomorrow that you should mention.
I'm speaking tomorrow. There's a brown bag event for the food lab.